Well, let's see if we can give a little context to the Green Party by-election win on Vancouver Island with a wider, a deeper view of the mood and preferences of the Canadian electorate these days. David Coletto of Abacus Data is here with me in our studio to pour over some new survey numbers from Abacus. David, good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Thanks for being here. First, a little background on the survey results. What do we need to know about the nuts and bolts?
So this was a big survey. We interviewed over 4,000 Canadians, representative of the population, in the last week of April. So it's a really good snapshot before entirely the by-election win last night for the Greens, but again, 4,000 allows us to go a little deeper than we normally would.
I think we're going to see some interesting numbers here about what people are thinking and what sort of possibilities that presents as we head into the election. Let's start with the direction we're heading as a country. How are Canadians feeling about that?
Well, the mood is certainly more negative than we've seen over the course of the life of this government. Over the last 2 months, we now have more Canadians who say they think the country's headed in the wrong direction as opposed to the right direction. And there's that moment in which those two lines cross, which coincides with the SNC-Lavalin controversy, which we had talked about in previous shows, of being really a almost like a reset button had been switched. And the public's view, not just of, as you're going to see in a minute, the Prime Minister or the government, but broadly speaking, I think there's a sense that perhaps the country as a whole isn't quite, isn't headed in that good direction.
Right. So if there is concern about where the country's headed, we see in these numbers the Trudeau government taking a hit over its performance.
It carries right over. And so when we ask people, you know, do you approve of the job the government's doing, we find only 32% of Canadians approve, which, again, if you look at our tracking, it's the lowest we've tracked. The Trudeau government's approval rating since they were elected in 2015. And so this is, we don't know if this is the bottom, but it's certainly, it's the bottom up till now.
Right.
And again, is proof that the public is having some significant reservations about the government's performance.
That takes us now to the voting intentions, the sort of horse races snapshot. What are we seeing? What are people saying?
We still have a conservative lead. It's smaller than other polls have shown. There's been, a few different polls that are telling a different story, but they're all saying one thing, and that is the Liberal vote is down, the Conservatives are either up or holding, and we're seeing a slight uptick in, for example, the Green Party vote. They're nowhere near competitive, but they're up at 9%. So overall, 34% for the Conservatives, 31% for the Liberals, 17% for the New Democrats, who, in our polling, have basically held steady. The New Democrats are down from where they were at the last election, but you know, they aren't really seeing much movement as a result of the Liberals falling. The NDP doesn't seem to be gaining.
And it's a big sample. So what do we see when you break it down by region?
Well, here we get some interesting regional stories. No surprise in the Prairies and Alberta, Saskatchewan and Manitoba. The Conservatives have massive leads there. This has been what we've seen for some time. In British Columbia, a much closer three-way, maybe four-way race developing where the Liberals have a slight advantage, but we see the Conservatives and the New Democrats not too far behind. In Quebec, the Liberals, this is the one area where the Liberals have been able to maintain a sizable lead. They lead by double digits over the Conservatives and the Bloc, kind of fighting it out for second. Mm-hmm. Noteworthy that the Greens are up at 10% in Quebec, only 1 point behind the NDP. Ontario, vote-rich Ontario, is basically deadlocked between the Liberals and the Conservatives, with the NDP in third. And interestingly, which I've been noticing more and more recently, Atlantic Canada is becoming more competitive. We've seen progressive Conservatives.
It was solidly Liberal in the last election.
Solid. And
people
even,
seem to be having some
even
polls.
almost 6 months ago, we were having polls that had the Liberals 20 points ahead in Atlantic Canada. Our poll only has them up by 5. So that's if these numbers hold, that sweep of every seat in Atlantic Canada looks to be in great doubt now for the Liberals.
Let's talk about the accessible voter pools. That's kind of really crucial to understand. Who might be prepared to give their support to you? What does that survey
Well, it's actually, I think, more important than the vote, because it tells us 5 months out from an election, who's open to even considering these parties? And there's a few things that are important to know. First is the decline of the Liberal, what we call accessible pool. Only a few months ago, at the end of 2018, a clear majority of Canadians would be open to voting Liberal. That's down to 48%. The New Democrats are around 44. That's where they've been now for almost half a year. The Conservatives have been the most consistent. Only about half of Canadians would consider voting Conservative, but that number doesn't fluctuate very much. So despite everything that's happened to the Liberals, the Conservatives haven't expanded the pool of people who would consider voting for. They've just been a little more effective at converting them. Mm-hmm. But the number to watch here, given what happened last night in Nanaimo-Ladysmith, is the Green Party number.
Yeah, what's happening there?
Where we now have 40% of Canadians saying they're open to voting Green. That doesn't mean they're voting Green, but it's up 7 points since July. It's the highest we've ever tracked them. And this, I think, is an indication that's what happened in PEI, what's happening in some other provinces, what happened in the by-election means more Canadians, more than ever before, are at least open to the idea of voting for the Green Party. And that's a relatively new phenomenon in Canada right
now. Let's talk about this next board. You also found 41% of the survey respondents, they're not totally nailed down in their choices. They could be persuaded to vote for a different party. The question is, where would they go? What did you find?
Yeah, there's incredible volatility. These are switchers. So 8% say they're very likely, people who had a preference, to be perhaps persuaded to change their mind. Another 33% said someone likely. And we look at where those voters are. This has been this way since I've been doing polling. The conservative core is much more solid. Only a third of them are really persuadable in the sense that they could move. But among Green Party supporters, among New Democrats, almost half or just over half say they could change their mind between now and Election Day. And even 42% of Liberal supporters are open to being persuaded. So there's it doesn't mean it's going to switch, but it suggests that if we think this is lock solid today,
it's not.
We're dreaming, because it's not likely going to be that way.
Let's finish on impressions of the leader and walk through those. Let's start with Justin Trudeau.
Yeah, and Justin Trudeau's numbers mirror his government's numbers. We saw for most of his term, fairly positive numbers for a leader to sustain over the course of his mandate. We now have, again, a sizable group of Canadians more likely to have a negative view of the prime minister than a positive one. It doesn't appear that the damage that the SNC controversy has had on him has started to reverse, that only 32% of Canadians have a positive impression. When we look at Andrew Scheer, the opposition leader.
Yeah, let's look at, he launched his big policy tour today. Now, this survey was done before he did that, but this may help us understand why he's trying to get some stuff in the window in front of Canadians and get better known.
Yeah, I mean, you can see both these lines go up, which is an indication that Canadians are increasingly getting to know Mr. Scheer. For him, though, there's still a large number of Canadians who don't really know who he is or are pretty neutral towards him. He is in actually an enviable position in that he has about equal numbers who like him and don't like him. That's, I think the Prime Minister would much rather have Andrew Scheer's numbers, which is ironic, today than perhaps only a few months ago. So Mr. Scheer is still in the place most opposition leaders are, in that they're undefined, they're not well known. But as we get closer and closer to that election, I think Canadians are going to pay more attention to this.
Jagmeet Singh, his party lost the seat in Nanaimo-Ladysmith last night. How's he doing with voters?
Well, if there's any upside in these numbers for the New Democrats, it's that his numbers are at least improving, at least since March, where we still have slightly more people who say they dislike or have a negative view of the NDP leader than a positive one. But you can see those numbers are starting to come back together. So we'll have to see whether this is a trend that's materializing or one that's just an anomaly, but Mr. Singh still has challenges with his own image and brand that don't appear to be changing very quickly for him right now.
And let's finish with, I guess, the leader of the moment today, and that's in many ways Elizabeth May. Some wind in her sails lately. What are the voters thinking of her?
Yeah, so we've been tracking this. We right around February, we started to see the gap between those who like Ms. May and those who dislike Ms. May opening up. She's really the only federal leader right now who can say more people like her than dislike her. And so I think but it's not to say there's something happening. Everyone's going to pile in and say, I want her to be the prime minister. But this is further evidence that she's well positioned now, unlike even a year ago, to take advantage of, I think, a political system that's fundamentally different than it was at the end of 2018.
Short amount of time we have left here. What's the upshot from the survey?
Well, the upshot is the Liberals are vulnerable. I think the Conservatives now have an advantage. They are probably the front runners headed into the election. The New Democrats are kind of static and don't seem to be gaining much traction. And I'm not going to say a green wave is building, but some of the fundamentals that might help propel the Greens forward and make historic gains seem to be developing in these numbers for them. So pretty exciting numbers.
Lots to watch. David Coletto, as always, thanks.
Thanks, Peter.